So I'm going to go ahead and create a class called public class. I'm going to call it retail item class test. Okay, it's going to basically test the class. I'll go ahead and create my main method. Okay, so I'll go ahead and I'll create my main method. Actually, I've done that. All right, so what I want to do is now create objects, because the question over here, actually, let me go ahead and copy the question also, so we can have it on both pages. Good. Okay, so question over here says, once you have written the class, write a separate program that creates three retail item objects and stores the following data in them. Right, so we have to go ahead and create three objects from this class. Right, so to do that, I'm going to basically create objects. So I'm going to start with the name of the class, retail item this way, the name of the class, and I'm going to define basically let me first finish typing it. So I'm creating an object from this class. I'll call the first object item one, right? So this is the same as creating, it's very similar to creating, say, an int variable like this and calling it number. This is the type and this is the variable name, right? You can think of this as a type, you can think of this as a variable name, but guess what? Once you compile this, right, Java is going to know that this is not one of the primitive type of variables. It's not like an int variable, it's not like a double variable, it's not a character variable. Java is going to know that and say, okay, so since it's not one of these, then it's going to assume that you are creating a class. It's going to assume that you are creating an object from this class, right? Okay. It's going to assume you're trying to create a class type variable or a reference variable, right? So it's going to do that. It's going to basically reserve this variable to hold an object of this class, right? So I'm basically creating a class type variable called item one of this type, just class type. Okay, this is going to be a reference variable or a class type variable of this type. Okay, all right. So now I'm going to. Now this is just creating a variable that's going to hold the object, right? But I haven't really created object in memory. So to do that, I need a new keyword. So new retail item. And this is basically going to create a new retail item object in memory. And then this equal sign is going to return the memory address of where that object is stored to this variable item one. So item one is basically going to reference that object, that particular item one object, which is created in memory. Item one is going to hold its memory address and it's going to be used to refer to that object. All right. Now, when we were defining a constructor, now this is basically using the constructor. We said the constructor was going to need three arguments. So we have to specify those arguments so that this particular object will have these values we are going to pass into this constructor set to its field. So right, this item one object is going to, okay, this item one object is going to have its own fields. So we have to do, based on the way we define our constructor, we said our constructor was going to take an argument. The arguments we're going to pass into this constructor, okay, are going to be set to the field of item one, which is description, units, and hand and price. So let's do that. It needs these fields, otherwise it's going to complain. So the first is the description. So let's set the description to let's set this description to jacket, you know, just to basically these values. So to jacket, and then the next thing was units on hand. Okay, so units on hand, we know it's an integer, So I'm going to set the unit on hand to basically whatever is here, which is 12, and then I'm going to set the price of it to 59.95. Okay, so basically we've created an object in memory, given it, initializing it with these values. Let's go ahead and create two more because the question said we should create three. So over here it says create three retail item object and stores the following data in them. So let's do this, call this retail item two and call this item three. Item two is going to be designer jeans. The units on hand is going to be 40 and then the price is going to be $34.95. Okay, the item three is going to be a shirt. The units on hand is going to be 20. And the price is going to be $24.95. Okay, so now we've created these objects. So now we can go ahead and display them. Now remember we said that first of all, let me compile this. And I'm going to save it in the same folder, like I said. So I'm going to save it as retail item class test. And then save it. Now we're fine. It doesn't have any error. So we've created the three object. But then we remember I said we can directly change, we can use this code that is outside of this retail item class to change directly the fields here or to act even see the contents of them. You can just directly say item one dot description is equal to, let's say, watch. When you try to compile this, it's going to complain and say that description has private access in retail item. You can see that it says description over here has private access. We are directly setting the description field in of item one to watch. We can directly do that because we said we made it private. So you can directly do that. The only way we said you can access this, basically because we made it private, it doesn't exist to this guy. Although it does exist, it's not accessible to this guy. It's not available to him because we made it private. The only way you can set the value of this is to use a public method in this class to set it. In this case, set description. So we'd have to say, for example, item one dot set description, and then we have to do that, right? The first thing I want to do is basically get the values of these using, you know, so for example, you can also directly print the values and say system.out.println. Sorry, my typing is not good. Item one dot, let's say description. You can't just directly view it like this because it's private. You can't access it. The only way you can access it is using the public methods because they're public and they're available to you. These are the only things you can use in this class. So if you try to print this also, and you run and you compile it, it's going to complain and say description has private access in retail item. You can't do that. So we'd have to use the public methods in the class to be able to access the fields or change the fields. Alright, so this is not supposed to be system. It's supposed to be system. Let me undo it and then see. It was system. Okay, so now I'll compile it. Okay, oh, that's why we had the other error. Okay, one error found. Yes, description has private access. So delete this. First thing I want to do is, let's try to emulate this table here. We want to go ahead and create a header. So I want to create this header first. Description, blank description, units on hand, and price. So let's do that. System.out.print, let's create first a blank, which is a blank space. We're going to emulate that with a tab. Okay, so backslash T basically creates a tab. The backslash and the T together combined with no space in between them, that is a tab key. It basically creates a tab when the interpreter sees this or the compiler sees this. It's going to create a tab. I want to create a couple, multiple ones, so maybe two tabs is good. And then followed by another tab, so basically two tabs or something like this and that, and followed by another tab, something like that. So I'm going to actually put three of them. And then description, so let's just take this down. although the reason it's yellow is because of the arrow. So let me just compile this. All right, so let's continue. Okay, so description, and I'm going to create multiple tab, let's say, and another tab, and then units on hand, and then another tab, and then actually let me make two tabs. Then price. Okay, so let's compile this and run it and see how it looks. And we can see that there's a space here. We have description, units, ahead, and price. I think the tabs are too much. Just close it a little bit. Compile this and then run. Now they are a bit close to each other. All right, so the next thing we want to do is display item one. So we can say we can create another system.out.print statement and say that, well, this time we're just going to say item number one, right? So let's see. Yeah, let's say item number one here. So like this. I'm going to go ahead and concatenate it with, we'll put item number one in a couple of tabs, so maybe two tabs. And then let's go ahead and concatenate it with the name of, with a description. So the description of item one. And to get the description, remember we said we can't just print the description directly. We can't just say item one dot description, just print it. We can't just do that. We have to use the accessor, the get description of, because it's public, get description of that particular object. Okay, it's a public method. So concatenate it with the description of item one. So it's going to be item one dot get description. And that's going to, remember, that's going to return the description. So once it's returned, we are printing it. Okay. So concatenate it with item one dot get description. It's a method, so I need my parentheses. And then we want to go ahead and concatenate it with a some tabs, so backslash t, and then the unit on hand for item one, right? So we want to go ahead and concatenate it with item over here. It's supposed to be item one, not item, sorry. And over here we want to change it to item one dot get unit on hand, right? Get units on hand. Okay, so over here we're saying get units on hand is going to return the units on hand, and we are printing it. So get units on hand, it's going to need the parentheses. And we want to go ahead and concatenate it with a couple more tabs. And then the price of item one. So item one dot get price. Like this. Okay. So let's compile this and then run it. And we can see that it's displaying correctly. It's displaying item one. It's displaying because we've set the values of the object. It's doing, it's basically given, it's given us the right value. So jacket 12 and 59.95, right? We can basically copy the same code and then emulate it for item two and item three. So here, like this. Change this to item number two, item number three. Say item two, item three. Change this to item two, three. Change this to two, three. Compile this, run it, and we can see that it's displaying it correctly. The only thing is we have to shift this for item two. Item two, we have to, I think, remove one of the tabs because it's too much. Okay. Oh, because of the designer genes and all that stuff. Okay. All right. So let's just move one of this for the units on hand and for the price. Actually, that should be enough. More. Let's see. Oh, that should be enough. All right. So we can see that it's displaying the correct, basically the correct information here. So it's working. All right, so we've basically finished, right? We The program said we should, once you've written the class, write a separate program that creates three retail item objects and stores the following data in them. Right? We've stored the following data in them by using the constructor. We can also manually set the values of these, of the filter of this object, by using the setters, the mutators, by using the set description, set unit and hands, and set price. These methods here, and they will change. We can try them, but we use the constructors to set the values, and we are using the accessors to get the values. Okay, or the getters to get the value. Now let's try to use the setters or the mutators to, for example, set one value and see if it will change here. So after we've used the constructor to set these values, we can go ahead and further, for example, change the description of item one. So item one dot set, we are using the setters now, set description we are using, for example, the set description here, and it takes in the description we want to set it to, and we are setting the description of that object to the user description we just passed here. So item one dot set description, we want to set it to, let's say, watch. We know that it's going to need a string, so I'm passing in watch. So now, although we've set item 1 to jacket 12 and 5995, we are overwriting it here. We are overwriting the description of item 1. So I keep on writing item 1. We are overwriting the description of item 1 to watch. So now this should change once I run it. And we can see that item 1 description has changed to watch. Okay, so this is just a way to use a setters. We didn't use it in this example, so I just wanted to use it at least once. So you can emulate it if you wanted to change it or change it around. But if I comment this out, this is exactly what the program needs. It needs these two files, the class. Oops. It needs these two files, the class, which is this page here. Yeah, basically all of this. And then it needs the program that's going to test the class. As long as they're in the same folder, that's fine. As long as they're in the same location, they're going to run fine. So when I compile this, now we are back to what the question asked for. You can see the same here. Okay, all right, so we're done. If you have any questions, please comment down below and I'll do everything to respond to them. Thank you very much for watching. Take care of yourselves, and I'll see you next time with the next program. All right. Bye-bye.